Please see the link in the description to download a worksheet for this video. Experiments can be dangerous. If you are a child, never do experiments unless your parent, guardian, or adult educator says it's all right and is there with you the whole time. This glacier is like a solid block of ice. Glaciers can be very tall and many miles long. Most of the time, glaciers slide down a mountain too slowly for us to notice. But when part of the glacier reaches the edge of the sea, it breaks off suddenly. The piece that falls off a glacier becomes an iceberg that slowly dissolves into the ocean. The movement of frozen water along the ground in the form of a glacier, then falling into the ocean to become an iceberg, are examples of movements in the water cycle. The U.S. Geological Survey is the federal agency that studies water resources, and they use this definition. The water cycle describes where water is on Earth and how it moves. When we first hear about the water cycle, we usually see a simplified picture like this that shows water coming down from the clouds as rain and then rising from the oceans back to the clouds. But the full details look more like this. Since this is an introductory video, we will focus on just a few definitions and movement types. Let's start with some definitions. Just as we use the word pool to mean a place where water is stored, like this swimming pool, geologists also use the word pool to mean a place where water is stored. But since geologists work on big scales, a geological pool means a large amount of water, such as an ocean, or a glacier, or an array of clouds, or groundwater. We classify water as being salty or salt-free. Another name for salty water is saline. All of the oceans have salt water, so they are saline water. 97% of the Earth's water is in the oceans. Lakes can have saline water, or a lake can be salt-free. Another name for salt-free water is fresh water. If the water in the lake flows out as new water comes in, such as if there are rivers above and below the level of the lake, then that water is usually fresh water. Almost all lakes and rivers in the U.S. are fresh water, including the Great Lakes. If a lake has no way for the water to run out of it, then that lake becomes very salty, so is called a saline lake. Another example of a saline lake is the Great Salt Lake in Utah, after which Utah's capital, Salt Lake City, is named. Rivers are also pools of water. When we think of a swimming pool, we don't think of water constantly coming in and going out. But in geology, a pool can have water coming and going, just like a freshwater lake has an inflow river and an outflow river. Likewise, there can be huge amounts of water that stay in rivers for many days, as that water travels hundreds of miles downhill towards the ocean. So we consider rivers to be pools. In general, rivers are freshwater. Wetlands are shallow water pools that include marshes, which have a lot of grass, and swamps, which have trees. These can be along the edges of oceans, where the high tide floods them and the low tide drains them, in which case they are saline. They may also be near rivers where they are filled when a river overflows. Wetlands, far from the ocean, are usually freshwater. Sometimes the water barely moves, but the soil cleans the water. There are collections of water underground, which is where our well water comes from, that is called groundwater. Groundwater is usually salt-free, so we call it freshwater. Glaciers are huge sheets of packed snow and ice. These are common in cold areas, such as Antarctica and near the North Pole. Glaciers are made of freshwater and store about 2/3, equal to 66%, of all freshwater on Earth. Since the top of mountains are cold, many mountains have glaciers near their tops. Glaciers grow when snow or rain falls on them and turns to ice. Towards the bottom of mountains, the air temperature gets warmer, so the glaciers melt. Or, if the base of a mountain is near the ocean, then parts of the glacier fall into the ocean. When pieces of a glacier fall into the ocean, it makes icebergs like these. About 90% of an iceberg is below the water's surface. We added green food coloring to water in an ice cube tray to make these ice cubes, so they are easier to see. Regardless of whether the water is fresh water or salt water, almost all of the ice is below the surface. The final water pool we'll mention are clouds. Although clouds are made of very small drops of water, big clouds can hold over 1 million gallons of water. They play major roles in the movements of the water cycle, which we will discuss in the next section. Here's a review of these definitions. We've also included graphs from the U.S. Geological Survey on where the Earth's water is. Please pause the video to read this if you wish. Now that we've discussed the major pools of water, let's turn our attention to water movement, which geologists call flux. Clouds can absorb water that rises from pools of water, then move that water when they are blown by the wind. Precipitation is the general word for any water falling from clouds. That includes rain, snow, hail, and sleet. Rivers are a major way that water moves across the land as the water flows downhill until eventually reaching sea level, which is the level of the oceans. Many of those major rivers are fed by smaller rivers or streams coming from high up on mountains. As we've noted earlier, water can also move slowly across the land in the form of frozen glaciers. There is also water movement underground in groundwater channels called aquifers. This is a picture of groundwater draining out of the sides of the Grand Canyon in Arizona. If you've ever air dried after being in a pool or the ocean, like these sea lions, then you've experienced evaporation. Evaporation is the scientific word for air drying. When water evaporates, it goes from a liquid state into water vapor. We cannot see water vapor, but it rises up to the clouds. When that water vapor reaches the cold air at the level of the clouds, it then becomes water droplets due to a process called condensation. This is the same reason that we can fog a mirror. When we breathe on a mirror, the invisible water vapor in our warm breath condenses into visible water droplets when it touches the cold mirror. But if the clouds go over some hot air, then the tiny drops of water that makes up the clouds will evaporate again, so they become invisible water vapor. The final water movement we'll describe is transpiration. Plants, including trees, pull water out of the soil and lift it to their leaves, where most of the water evaporates and rises to make clouds. Just a few hours ago, when the tide was high, this sand was underwater. Now it's dry because of evaporation, due to the sun's heat. Evaporation is the key step in the water cycle. Without it, the water cycle would not exist. And since the sun powers evaporation, the sun powers the water cycle. Since more than 70% of the Earth's surface is covered by the oceans, most of the water that evaporates from the Earth's surface to the clouds is rising from the oceans. Yet rainwater has no salt. To demonstrate why, we simulated ocean water by putting 5 grams of salt in this beaker with some water, then waited several days for it to evaporate, and when we measured it, almost all of the salt remains. The water cycle is one of the major cycles that involves several Earth systems that we learn about in K-12 education. Clean and plentiful water are essential to our communities, so there are many government agencies that study and regulate water supplies and use. There is an entire branch of civil engineering dedicated to water management. The water cycle makes it possible to use hydroelectric dams like this one, which is a renewable energy source. Rainwater keeps the lake at a high level behind this wall so that there is enough water to run down channels inside this wall, which then spins a generator's turbine to make electricity. In our experiment on evaporation, we learned that evaporation of salt water leaves the salt behind. We can use this fact to harvest salt from the oceans with very little energy. People pipe in ocean water and wait for the water to evaporate. That leaves behind lots of salt. Here's a summary of the topic we just covered. Please pause the video to read this if you wish. If you're interested in practice tests that are similar to state exams, but with detailed, colorful explanations for each answer, then please see our apps in the App Store. Many of these are free and none expire or limit their function. Since we only make educational products for children, none of our apps have third-party advertising, in-app purchasing, or connect to the internet. Please subscribe if you'd like to be notified of future educational videos we make. Thanks for your attention.